وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله وصفوته من خلقه وحبيبه قد بلغ الرسالة وأدى الأمانة ونصح الأمة وكشف الغمة وجاهد في سبيل دينه حتى أتاه اليقين فاللهم اجزه عنا وعن والدينا وعن الإسلام والمسلمين خير ما جازيت به نبيا عن قومه ورسولا عن أمته اللهم أحينا على سنته وأمتنا على ملته واحشرنا تحت لوائه وأوردنا حوضه واسقنا من يده الشريفة شربة هنيئة لا نظمأ بعدها أبدا. أما بعد, brothers and sisters, we start with a definitive due condolence and invitation for support for our families, brothers and sisters and children in Lebanon and in Gaza. Both are under a lot of stress and a lot of pressure to recover from the explosion in Beirut and the attacks of the Israeli authorities over Gaza. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cure all of their sick and injured, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give mercy and accept as martyrs all of those who have been killed as a result of either event in either places. Whenever there is something serious like a massive disaster or something unusual like an earthquake or volcano, some eternal questions arise, mainly by people who are either do not understand or people who are either atheist or agnostics. They ask some eternal questions. Why is evil allowed in this universe? And they attach to this question another illogical and separate question, saying, if there is God, why should there be evil? Don't we all say that God is good? Why would a good God let bad things happen? There are short answers to this, and there are long answers to this. The short answer is, next time you create your own creation and you want to be ultimately merciful, more merciful than Allah, then you can manage it the way you want. That's a short answer. But the detailed answer is, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not hide anything from us. From the beginning of creation, He told us that we are created to be tested. So let us assume that the atheists have a legitimate question and say, why isn't this life paradise? Well, what about the next life? What do you want? Do you want the next life to be hell? If this life is going to be paradise, where is the test? Well, let me ask you another question in answer to this. We are all asked to be patient in dealing with each other. Are we normally required to be patient with people who are treating us well or people who are not treating us well? You are patient with people who do not treat you well, right? So the test is to accept the qadr of Allah and to push back against mistreatment, occupation, aggression, and all of the negatives of humans as much as you can. But at the end of the day, you have limited power to push back, so you resort to Allah to fill in the gap between your power and your needs. So we always say, Alhamdulillah, for whatever is good. And we accept and say, Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un, whenever something bad happens, right? Why do atheists celebrate in general, at the expense of overgeneralization, why do they celebrate disasters? Because they think it proves their point that this universe has no God, or else the God that people created in their head is not as merciful as they claim, because he allows evil to go on. The Quran has definitive answers for this. Number one, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَظْلِمُ النَّاسَ شَيْئًا. Allah never wrongs people a thing. Not anything, nothing. Which means what? Whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala puts us through, we deserve it, or we need it, or both. Let us say, somebody who is running far away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then Allah puts him through a test or a trial of any kind. What happens? Normal believers would come back to Allah. Where do the atheists go when they are tested? They continue in their despair and hopelessness into destroying themselves. But the believers, when they are given something good, they are grateful. When they are given something that is difficult, a trial or a test, they are patient. And this is only for the believers. This is the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He says, عَجَبًا لِأَمْرِ الْمُؤْمِنِ. The matter of the believer is always amazing. Always amazing. إِنْ أَصَابَتْهُ سَرَّاءَ شَكَرْ فَكَانَ خَيْرًا لَهُ. If he is gifted with something good, he is grateful and this is good for him. And if he is afflicted with something difficult, a test or a trial, he is patient and this is good for him. At the end of the hadith, the Prophet ﷺ says, وَلَيْسَ ذَٰلِكَ لِأَحَدٍ إِلَّا لِلْمُؤْمِنِ. These two approaches to the good or the difficult are exclusive for the believer. So it's a gift. It's a gift to be grateful. It's a gift to be patient. And it's a gift to refer everything to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So as you could see, those eternal questions do not want to learn. They want to challenge Allah. They want to challenge the believers or to deter them from claiming that Allah is good or whatever Allah brings to us is good. But today I'm going to take you through some ayat in the Quran that will give you clear answer, because we people, unfortunately, are created, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, ظَلُومًا جَهُولًا. We are created with the instincts to do wrong and to act ignorantly. إِنَّهُ كَانَ ظَلُومًا جَهُولًا. This is the attitude of man when left to his own devices. Not man when he believes. Because the word man in the Quran, al-insan, is always a reflection of the crude man. Man without faith. Man without reference in his life, without Allah's guidance. Then man behaves ignorantly and wrongly all the time. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in the Quran that we do not know what is good and what's bad. We've gone over this before, but in this context, it warrants that we go over this again and again. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَعَسَى أَن تَكْرَهُوا شَيْئًا وَهُوَ خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ. It may be that you hate something that is good for you. Good here means it is in your best interest. But sometimes we judge something as good because we want it. In fact, most of the time, this is how people judge what is good. If I want it, it is good for me. I feel it's good for me. Who are you to tell me what's good for me? No, when Allah speaks, you better listen. So sometimes we think that something is very bad, and it happened almost to every human being, that something that comes to you from Allah unexpectedly and you think negative about it, you think it's the worst thing that could ever happen to you. But then later on, you may discover, I have discovered over time, that many times what I think as bad, Allah turns it out to be the best thing that ever happened to me. Have you found the same? I'm sure everybody has stories to tell on this point. The same. وَعَسَىٰ أَن تُحِبُّوا شَيْئًا. And maybe you like something, you love something very much. وَهُوَ شَرٌّ لَكُمْ. And it is bad for you. Bad here means it is not in your best interest. So the car you want, or the home that you vie to get, or whatever position, sometimes it turns to be great, sometimes it turns to be the worst thing you've ever done in your life. It depends. So our judgment is flawed by definition. This is what the ayah is saying. And the conclusion in the ayah is, وَاللَّهُ يَعْلَمُ وَأَنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. Allah knows and you do not know. So if Allah knows and we do not know, then how do we judge what is good and what's bad? Oh, my son was 7 years old and he passed away. He was lovely. He was great. He was even praying, memorizing Quran. He was doing great in school. I loved him. Why would Allah take him away from me? Well, ask yourself the other question. Who gave him to you? Why don't you ask this question? Did you produce him in a lab or something? So your child and all the gifts that we get in this life are given to us by Allah. So the question is, does the one who give for free has the right to take without being asked? Does he or does he not? If somebody gifts you something and he tells you, this is a trust and a gift and a test. And Allah told us all of this in the Quran. Whatever he gives us, good or bad, it is a trust, a gift, and a test. So he didn't hide it from us. So we know that before we ask, why take it, why don't we ask, why did you give him to us? Do we not all love children? Do we not all love to have families with good kids and stuff? We all do. Don't we pray to Allah to bring us kids who are good? رَبَّنَا هَبْ لَنَا مِنْ أَزْوَاجِنَا وَذُرِّيَّاتِنَا قُرَّةَ أَعْيُنٍ. Right? So when we ask him, and he gives us as a gift, and as a trust, and as a test, it is up to him when to take it. He gives us our life, right? Did we pray for him to create us? He created us because he saw fit in his divine knowledge and wisdom that this is his decree. إِنَّمَا أَمْرُهُ إِذَا أَرَادَ شَيْئًا أَن يَقُولَ لَهُ كُنْ فَيَكُونَ. So now, you did not create yourself. You did not create your own child. You did not amass your own wealth without his help, right? You do not even digest the food you eat without his help. Why do you equate your head with his wisdom? So the question is about arrogance, not about justice. The question is about putting my head next to Allah's wisdom and knowledge and competing with him and telling him why this and why that. So the Quran gives us some short answer like the one I gave in the beginning. In two places, he says, أَمْ خُلِقُوا مِنْ غَيْرِ شَيْءٍ أَمْ هُمُ الْخَالِقُونَ. Have they been created from nothing? Did they come here as a coincidence? Right? Am humul khaliqoon? Or are they themselves the creators? Did they create themselves? Did they create the life that they live in? The resources they are enjoying? The children that they have? The spouses they enjoy each other? So, very central question. Very central question. Are we the creators? In the other short answer, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لَا يُسْأَلُ عَمَّا يَفْعَلُ. Once you recognize Allah as God, right? You cannot ask your God why and why not, let alone interrogating him about what he does. And this is what the atheists and others who raise those frivolous questions do. They want Allah to be answerable to their own level of knowledge and mindset. So Allah gives us examples in our real life that at certain times, with certain level of knowledge and experience and wisdom that you reach as you grow older, there are things that you cannot explain to young children. We all know that, right? We all know that. So we have to be careful not to question Allah. If you say he is God, then treat him for the God he is, for the creator he is. Now somebody may say, but atheists do not acknowledge him altogether. Fine, then why ask him? If he doesn't exist, why ask him? So it is a logical dichotomy that they want to resolve by distracting the believers from their faith and the rules by which they live, raising those questions. If you don't recognize Allah, that's your right. You have the right to disbelieve completely. But don't ask him questions, because unless you don't believe yourself. So you claim he doesn't exist, but you're talking to him. You claim he doesn't have power. You claim he didn't create you, but you want him to be answerable to you. Who is him to you? If he doesn't exist, don't ask him questions. Then, in another place, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, وَيَدْعُ الْإِنسَانُ بِالشَّرِّ دُعَاءَهُ بِالْخَيْرِ. Man prays and supplicates and invokes and calls Allah for what is evil as if he is asking for what is good. How more blind can man be? He is asking for things that can lead to his own destruction, right? And he is doing things that lead definitively to his own destruction. So is man wise enough to challenge Allah's wisdom with his wisdom? To challenge Allah's knowledge with his knowledge? The answer is obviously no. Man will continue to be ignorant from the day he is born until the day he leaves this life. And Allah taught us, وَفَوْقَ كُلِّ ذِي عِلْمٍ عَلِيمٍ. Above every knowledgeable person, there is one who is more knowledgeable. And the surah we recite frequently, Surah Al-Kahf, every week, shows us the example. Moses, alayhi salam, a prophet and a messenger of Allah, he is definitely provided with divine knowledge, but Allah wanted to teach him and to teach us that above every knowledgeable person, there is one who is more knowledgeable. So he sends him through the desert, across the sea, to meet a man. Some call him Al-Khidr, some call him the good man or the righteous man, to teach him the ways of Allah that could not be inferred or concluded by human deduction. Moses, with all the knowledge he had, he could not figure out why this man would destroy the ship or make a hole in the ship. So he asks a question. He has the right to ask. But he had promised, I'm not going to ask you until you tell me what you're doing and why you're doing it. But he couldn't hold it. His knowledge forces him to question curiosity, inquisitiveness, reasoning, believing that this is a righteous man. Why would he destroy a ship? People use it back and forth. Why would he destroy it? Or killing the young man. Why would he kill a young man who is innocent? The same like the question of the atheist. Umm Salama, radiallahu anha wa ardaha, Zaynab bint Jahsh, radiallahu anhum ajma'in, she asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, أَنَهْلَكُ وَفِينَ الصَّالِحُونَ, could a community as a whole be destroyed while we still have righteous people amongst us? This is atheist question. Zaynab, radiallahu anha, is the mother of the believers. She is our mother. She is not just a believer. She is the mother of the believers. Right? So he says, yes, bala, إِذَا كَثُرَ الْخَبَثِ, if corruption and mischief are well spread, yes, a community could perish with the righteous ones in the middle of them. That is another answer that we get directly from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So why volcanoes come to take children and women and the helpless and the handicapped and this and this? Well, the rest of the answer is another hadith from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he says, "Kullun yub'athu 'ala niyyatihi." Everyone will be raised up on the day of judgment based on his level of righteousness and relationship with Allah, which is a very deep answer, because it says this life is not a life for reward and punishment. So whatever happens to us here, it is not your reward or your ultimate punishment. What happens here is only to test and redirect. So what happens here is raising the alarm, giving you a flag to pay attention, forcing you to go back to Allah and ask Him for cure, for money, for resources, and so on and so forth. This is the purpose of it. So the purpose is not punishment. But the question of the atheist presumes that whatever happens here, it is either the reward or the punishment. They are blinded. They don't recognize Allah, and we don't expect them to recognize the Day of Judgment, or that there is reckoning and accountability on the Day of Judgment, or reward or punishment. So they, in their own limited blind minds, they limit everything to what they see and what they touch, and they judge it their own way. We the believers know that beyond the visible world in which we live, there are worlds of the invisibles. هناك عوالم الغيب. And only through the Quran, we know who is living beyond our tangible life. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala show us all truth as truth, and help us follow it, and show us falsehood as falsehood, and help us avoid it. الحمد لله وكفى والصلاة والسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله وصفوته من خلقه وحبيبه قد بلغ الرسالة وأدى الأمانة ونصح الأمة وكشف الغمة اللهم صل وسلم وبارك عليه وعلى آله وصحابته ومن اتبع سنته بإحسان إلى يوم الدين اللهم اهدنا فيمن هديت وعافنا فيمن عافيت وتولنا فيمن توليت وقنا واصرف عنا شر ما قضيت اللهم اغفر لنا من خشيتك ما تحول به بيننا وبين معصيتك ومن طاعتك ما تبلغنا به جنتك ومن اليقين ما تهون به علينا مصائب الدنيا ومتعنا اللهم بأسماعنا وأبصارنا وقوتنا ما أحييتنا واجعله الوارث منا واجعل ثأرنا على من ظلمنا ولا تجعل مصيبتنا في ديننا ولا تجعل الدنيا أكبر همنا ولا مبلغ علمنا ولا إلى النار مصيرنا وإذا أردت بقومنا فتنة فنجنا منها يا مولانا غير خزايا ولا مفتونين ولا مبدلين ولا مغيرين اللهم لا تدع لنا في يومنا هذا ذنبا إلا غفرته ولا دينا إلا قضيته ولا مريضا إلا شفيته ولا مبتلا إلا عافيته ولا مجاهدا إلا نصرته ولا ميتا إلا رحمته ولا فقيرا إلا أغنيته. اللهم اختم لنا بخاتمة السعادة أجمعين مع النبيين والصديقين والشهداء والصالحين. أقول قولي هذا واستغفر الله لي ولكم، فستذكرون ما أقول لكم، وأفوض أمري إلى الله، إن الله بصير بالعباد. وأقم الصلاة.